Hi, everybody, and welcome to Activism Insights. Today is the June 14th in 2017. Thanks a lot, everybody, for coming in and listening, and want to reiterate why this program is here, and that is to acknowledge, support, and motivate and provide tools to those TVP activists out in the field. We know you're there. We know just how hard you work every day. And how much we appreciate and want to help support you in that. Got a really terrific guest this today. And I know a lot of people have either read some of his contributions or know about him, and some of you have had the opportunity to meet him. Today's guest is Saso Luznar, and I'd like to introduce him now today. Hi.
Hello, Luke. It's good to see you.
It's wonderful to see you, and thanks a lot for being here. Thanks for taking the time out of your busy schedule. It's late in the evening, and he's just finished the thing so he could make time for us, and we thank you for that. You know, we'll go through some of the preliminary questions that we always ask everybody. It should be of interest, I might note, at this juncture, that how important it is to find out how people learn. However it is that people are learning about the Venus Project, Roxanne, and the resource-based economy, we should put more effort into those areas because that's what's attracting people, and even what was used and what kind of material or approach was used that attracted you, we'd like to keep duplicating that. So welcome, and one of the first questions is, how did you learn of the Venus Project's resource-based economy, Saso?
Well, I don't want to spend too much time talking about about me, honestly, because we got so much stuff to cover. But just a quick overview. I got to know about the Venus Project in late 2010, and it was just online on Facebook. One of my friends posted a 10 minute clip of Jacques and Roxanne. I think it was the interview on Russia Today, and that was really the first time that I heard anybody really talk about not just the problems in a unique way, but also come up with solutions, which you know, I didn't really put together right away at the time, but it sounded like something that you know, could work, and I've never heard anything like that before. So that just kind of interested me into trying to get to know more about it. And then just YouTube, you know, internet, found all sorts of lectures, you know, Jacques' movies, Future by Design, lectures featured in Zeitgeist, all that stuff. And then, yeah, just went from there on, I guess. Uh-huh. I was lucky that I joined the team back home in Slovenia, which was at the time already up and running. A core group of people were already there, so that made it a little bit easier, because I had the opportunity to actually physically meet people for coffee and talk about these things. Yeah. And I think that you know, helps a lot. So I try to, you know, I try to return that favor if I can, wherever I can.
Sure. And so it was through a friend on Facebook that you had learned of the resource-based economy, and you know, it also brought up the fact of where are you? And so originally you're from Slovenia and came to this country. Where are you residing currently? Do you reside in any one place, or do you move around throughout the United States?
Well, so the whole, the project itself kind of put me on a pretty interesting path. Currently, I am in Florida. I'm in Venus right now. But my wife is from New Jersey. So I'm usually between New Jersey and Florida at the moment, and I'm currently still in the process of getting the visa and work permits and all that stuff through the immigration. So.
Fantastic. Yeah. And we'll come back to this, but you actually just did an excursion out to California doing a bunch of filming and regards to archiving, and I'd like to talk about that sometime. The other question is why? Why is it that you take your life, and why do you to support the Venus Project's research-based economy? Why do you do that? What is it about it?
Well, I guess I guess when you start off, like back in that late 2010, you don't, I mean, that's not the first thing that you think about is not, oh, I want to dedicate my life to this, right? But it does give you that little bit of an itch as far as, all right, you know, what's really going on out there? And quite honestly, I never really thought about these things before. I was, you know, I was fortunate to grow up in a fairly good environment, you know, with my parents being decently well off, so that I was never hungry and all that stuff. So, you know, I was quite fortunate. So, most of these things, I never really seriously considered or talked about or researched. So first it was just, you know, that interest of, well, you know, how does this stuff really work? Is it true what, you know, this elderly gentleman is talking about, or, you know, what's going on? And then, you know, and then as you do more and more research, you know, you see that, that all that stuff is happening. And, as you get, you know, more and more involved, that's just a gradual road to get to that. But after a while, probably after about 2 years, I just, you know, I realized that being in a fairly fortunate position that I'm in, that, you know, many, many people are in a lot worse off than what I was. And so I was able to reorganize, I guess, my life in such a way that I had more time to dedicate to this and you know, do more, because I know that a lot of people are just not able to do more because they have so much more problems. They have trouble with just getting from, you know, 1 month to the other and all that stuff. And not that I was never at that point, but, you know, still. At least I didn't have, you know, a couple $100,000 of debt and all that stuff.
Yeah, this system's not known for trying to help and support, motivate, and provide the tools for people. And I think that any level of activism or understanding that you have of this direction, that there's a level of sacrifice that's involved. And even through the examples and the way that we live and the choices we make. So it's a very difficult path to transition. Another question that I have would be the kind of activism, you know, one of the things that we wish to do is to help those in the field and, you know, the different methods, and also about what's going on at the Venus Project, the different, you know, different areas. Now, we have a tremendous all-out effort on training and helping the members and the activists become more fluid in their delivery, a better and well-grounded and established understanding. Is there anything that you might add about the training that we have involved and now make available?
Before we go into the training part, I one of the things that helped me get from the, you know, regular rat race, I guess, of being in your, you know, 9-to-5 or even worse usually jobs is one of the things that I tried to do, and that's, again, not everybody maybe is in a position to do that, but you should try and examine it and see if you can. You know, I try to cut out of my life the bullshit, you know, that took away my time and my money a lot of times. And I try to see, you know, what are the things that are really important and where are areas where, you know, I can let go of some things and minimize my expenses in life. And therefore be able to work less and have more time to volunteer.
Yeah, right.
And that was really about a year and a half, 2 year process for me, until I got to a point where, you know, I reduced my expenses a lot, and that made me be able to work less, and that made me able to, you know, volunteer more. So I would dedicate a lot more time. I don't know if that's something that you out there can do. Like I said, again, not everybody can do that. But if you can, I think that's a good first step to free up more time to even do something, you know, whatever it is. But then, yeah, like you were talking, we're kind of trying to do our best in on many different fronts, and we're gonna talk about as many of these as we get to. But like you already mentioned, education is really one of the, you know, important topics that we cover. Right now we're basically trying to get out a in general, let's say a three-level system of people getting involved, meaning that getting involved with fairly basic teams, global teams that we have, for which we're gonna shortly in the next couple of weeks have like a basic orientation, if that's what's gonna be called. I don't know yet, but it's gonna be an online, free online course. It's going to be fairly short, like a 10-hour course that anybody can go through.
Fantastic.
And then after that, there's going to be, you know, some tools for you available to get involved. And then these teams that we already have now, and more that are being established, you know, social media, translations, web design, transcriptions, graphics, all these things, will be more able to take on, you know, more people and get more people to collaborate. And then at the same time, there is a lot of work in the background, working on procedures within those teams so that there's, you know, work processes and all that stuff. Which is something that, you know, that was that we always wanted to improve, and now, thanks to, you know, some of the people that are, let's say, consistently working hard in the background that you don't often see, that I can mention here, like Borislav from Bulgaria and you know, many others, Ray with the translation and transcription and editorial. All that stuff. Just so many people.
Dig it.
So yeah. So maybe, you know, some of us you see us more often, but that doesn't, you know, that doesn't mean that there's not a whole bunch of people on the background that are doing a lot of really, really good and important work. So
yeah. And it's constantly being upgraded. It's constantly being reanalyzed, and what was effective and where it needed work.
Yeah. So that's definitely one. That's definitely the first aspect, and then we have the Socio Cyberneering Education Project. So that's already online now, we've had very good feedback on that so far. There's been so many people that have applied that we have a waiting list. Theo has a waiting list, so not. People can't start right at this moment because there's not enough room for everybody. So people like me that are going through that course, we're gonna try and get to the end of it as fast as we can, and then hopefully facilitate, you know, more people, because this is really the only pure educational course, in the sense that when you finish this course, the idea is that you are able to then facilitate this course to others. So
fantastic.
Which basically means a doubling of your time when you do that. So it's a very intensive course. It takes about, you know, it takes about 2 years, with about, you know, an hour a day to 10 hours a week, somewhere in that area, depending. But at the end of the day, you know, what's 2 years in comparison to, you know, all that knowledge of, you know, 7 years. 100 years of work. So so I think it's still a good deal.
Absolutely, absolutely. And it's almost, in a sense, trainers to train others.
Yeah, and then the people that would finish this course would also be involved in creating, you know, new courses and creating content, video content and other content, depending on, you know, what they want to dedicate more to. So yeah, and then kind of the middle ground that we have between those two options is the points of contact. Which is people that get involved and take on a little bit more of an organizational role, so that holds more responsibilities than just being a member of the team, because it's basically being the person that tries to coordinate a local team in a certain area. So some of the responsibilities are that you are the person that people contact when they get to know about the project and they're from your area. And then also we try to facilitate some of the tools for these points of contact so that they can start by organizing themselves and maybe joining some events and you know, participating in the events, maybe having a booth there and, you know, give out flyers, answer questions about the project, maybe
lectures, presentations.
Well, ideally lectures and presentations when you get more experience, for sure. Ideally, of course, once we get more room for that, people, you know, would go through the mentor course as well. I mean, the socio-seminary course,
right,
with a mentor. So that's kind of the middle ground, let's say, that we have right now.
And that's a 20-week course, is that correct?
Yeah, so that's a 20-week course. And that basic orientation or that basic quiz, you go through that the same as all the people that want to join any team. And that's again free online. You can do it in as fast or as slow as you want. You can do it over a period of a week or 2 weeks, or you can do it over a weekend. You know, there's about 10 hours of material, you answer some questions and some quizzes, etc., and then you start. But then for the people that want to become points of contact, yes, after that we have a group setting, which we call the point of contact orientation, which
cool.
is 20 weeks, and it's about 2 to 3 hours a week, and that kind of prepares you for this organizational role. It's a lot of the work, or at least we're trying to get more and more of the work to be kind of hands-on, so that people in the orientation are actually doing the things that they are going to be doing when they become a point of contact. So that's the idea.
Right.
And then, of course, whoever finishes that course and becomes a point of contact, they're encouraged to learn more and go on maybe to the mentor course like some of us have, or to the socio-sabernering course, or to at least go through the lectures that you have right there in your background, the classic lecture series set and the 2010-11 lecture series set. So, you know, those are valuable. And, of course, you know, the book should be something
yes.
that we should go through anyway.
Totally, totally. It was always a procedure manual, very, very important. And read it multiple times, you just become very founded and grounded. It seems very clear. It can be so instrumental in your delivery. It just contains everything. Chuck has done such a wonderful job with the best that money can't buy. I think it's a foundation and principal tool for any activist and any person that really wants to make a difference and try to, you know, support and encourage a resource-based economy. I'm reminded when Jock would talk about retraining soldiers. And I kind of feel like that's exactly what we're doing. I think that what we are able to do and that you're doing is to provide training so that there can be people who go back out into the world all over this planet as peacemakers, as a instrument to help enable people to have a resource-based economy enacted. And it's just a wonderful, wonderful thing. And one thing I'd like to ask is that, say, for instance, somebody wants to take the initial orientation and then they go on to a POC. Each one is a fundamental building off of the other. And they decide, well, you know, I'd like to go into linguistic team, the Linguistic International team, or I'd like to. Yeah. They have that ability, right? They don't have to be, okay.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, this, you know, as volunteers, we're really not restricted. I would much rather somebody, do translations than not do anything. So, you know what I mean? So if somebody is a point of contact and they have to step back for whatever reason, be it they don't want to do it anymore or they just don't have the time, you know, at that time to dedicate, because it is a responsibility to some degree, of course. But, you know, I would much rather see that person say, well, you know, I can't be a point of contact, but, you know, I want to help with the translations or I want to help with transcriptions because it's more flexible as far as my time. And, you know, and that's great. Yeah, of course. And then a lot of times some of the POCs are also doing linguistic things.
Sometimes,
you know, like myself, you know, a lot of times somebody has to organize whatever translation project we have, and ideally we want to find a project coordinator that would be just for the linguistic team. But if there isn't one yet, then a lot of times it's the POCs that have to do that too. So yeah, it depends. It depends on the size of your team. I wanted to maybe just go back, because one of the things that you mentioned I thought was important. One of the things that that a lot of times we kind of forget, or maybe don't necessarily think about too much, is that, you know, a lot of times when we get exposed to these ideas, we don't really have people to talk to about these ideas, or a lot of times the people around you are not sympathetic or excited about these ideas like you are. And so, for example, the, you know, point of contact orientation and joining these beginner teams gives you that contact.
Yes.
It gives you the option of you know, having some kind of communication with people that are interested in the same things. And and, you know, for me, I know back when I started, that was really something that was that was important. I was always looking forward to meetings like that, you know, so that you can share ideas and that people can kind of correct your way, you know, your way of thinking or you know, whatever, if you have some kind of misconceptions. So
projections.
Yeah. Which is how it is, you know, in the beginning anyway. So
sure.
So I think that's an added bonus of orientations like this, is that you kind of start to get into a team, into a group of people that are, you know, looking at the world in a similar way.
Right on. And, you know, there are so many different areas that people can become involved with. There's media teams, there's social media, there's linguistic, there's just all kinds of different areas where we need help. And sometimes people may not be aware of that. And there's an effort now to make it easier, more streamlined and informative and effectual, so that they can become involved and we can attain in these objectives and directives. So we're going to talk more about that. Eventually we'll have an interview with Ray on the linguistics. We'll have an interview with Jennifer which is your wife, Jennifer Hughes. You guys are married. What a team, yeah. Huh? It's like finding another Roxanne. Can you imagine? And you guys do so much work. You're all over the place, and a lot of people don't know that. That's why I just think it's wonderful to meet you up close and see you're a real human being. You're just like any brother, dad, son, that you've taken it, you know, and the amount of incredible effect that you've generated and contributed is just absolutely wonderful. And everyone has that opportunity. You have to have a certain knowledge in order to be able to continue or be effectual in some of those areas. And everyone is welcome. We have so many different areas that people can become involved with and make this real in their life and contribute significantly towards this transitional period and the work that we all have to do. Go ahead.
No, I just wanted to say that I mean, you know, obviously it would be helpful if, you know, if I would have some kind of, you know, academic scientific background or something like that. You know, that's definitely positive for the project if that is the case. But in my case, that's not how it was. I had none of my really experience in life were things that would be beneficial to what we're doing here, really. So I started from, you know, from nothing. That was, you know, just asking a whole bunch of questions and really learning about the world. That's yes. Kind of what the first year, 2 years was, you know, even more than that. I think that's, you know, I was lucky later on, you know, to have met Jennifer, like you said, through the project, because a lot of times that's again a potential problem. You know, you get to know about this and then your wife or your husband, you know, is not supportive, and it's very hard, you know. Right at home you have that kind of friction. It's very hard to dedicate time then, if that's the case. So yeah, that's that is another, I guess, that is another pretty fortunate set of circumstances. That's how it happened. But
and also that you've been able to take life experiences. I mean, you served in the service. You have a tremendous amount of knowledge, and that through your experiences in life that actually empower you. Now, I have to say that often when somebody holds up, and I'm trying to talk to somebody on the street, you know, or out in the world, and when a guy's holding up a proclamation, hey, I have an MBA, or I have a BA, or, you know, I'm this, or I'm that, I find it difficult because they're so locked into the system that it's difficult for them to give that up, that they are so indoctrinated in those different BAs and masters and this and that and economics, that it's difficult because they're so locked into it. I've often felt that, you know, not having them sometimes enables people to have a wider range of openness. So, you know, sometimes we can take the simplest things that we have experienced in life and redirect them towards what we're doing based on those experiences and that are real for us, or what we take away from those experiences. So, and you've been able to do that.
Well, I mean, one of the things, I guess, that regardless of what your background is, one of the things that is always helpful is to be able to, you know, say that you don't know, and then, you know, look into things in such a way that you try to see and consider what the you know, the evidence or the observation of nature and the system shows you, regardless of whether or not it's against your principles up to then, you know. And there was a lot of things that I didn't agree with when I started off, because, you know, with my background in like I said, things that are not really relevant to the project. Yeah. You know, Jacques would touch on many topics that I didn't like to hear. But you know, if if you have the ability to say, well, you know, I don't really know. You know, I guess, you know, I believed something because other people told me. So,
right.
You know, so maybe I should, you know, revisit that and see it from a different perspective. And then once, if you're able to do that, I feel that's, you know, that's very important.
Absolutely.
And that should still be the case, you know, all the time. We should try to revise our value systems. We should try to revise our behavior patterns, habits, all that stuff. Otherwise, you're standing still. You know?
Right. Everything is constantly emerging.
Yeah.
Yet we're not taught to welcome change, to look at what are the advantages towards me personally, my fellow man in the earth. We're just not taught to do that. We're taught to accept and reinforce and you know, remain aligned and adherence and obeyance of what is established.
Yeah.
And anything of it is based in reality or, you know, balance.
Well, my attitude has always been, even, you know, even if for whatever reason I would stop volunteering, you know, for the project tomorrow, I just, with the amount of information and knowledge that I've gotten in these 6 and something years, you know, I can just be grateful for everything. You know, there's nothing that I would be sorry about for dedicating all this time. It was definitely worth it. You know, it was the most, you know, kind of the most relevant thing in my life, I guess, and you know, just getting to know these things, getting to know how the world works at 30, you know.
Right, 30, how nice to be 30, man.
For some it's later, for some it's earlier, and a lot of times people come here and you know, say, well, I wish I would known about this sooner, but ultimately, you know, it could have been worse. You might have never known about it, but you wouldn't be here now, you know. So that's how I look at it. I was lucky that I found out about it.
Well, and your determination, your willingness to go and look, you know, it's really a breakthrough for people to even consider anything outside of Paris Hilton's breakfast, Kim Kardashian's handbag, sports, war. This is the kind of stuff they're surrounded with. That's that a lot of people here in America talk about. And I think that probably is reflected all over the planet, that environment that they're around and an established system. So it's really breakthrough when somebody can consider, you know, another direction, or that there is not exactly what they have always thought it was. And that can be very confrontational for people. And the way that the delivery is not putting them down. I used to think that way too. You know, different ways of helping them to see that there's an alternative and that they have a choice instead of what direction is already established, that there's a different way and they just may not know about it yet. I'd like to talk about the research center. A lot of people have said, well, you know, Jock's no longer there. There is absolutely nothing different. In fact, you know, it's more powerful, those tours. And I got to spend, you know, I was there for a short period of time earlier this year. And man, look, you know, I've spent some time researching. I love it. I could never get enough, like a lot of us. And I learn so much far out stuff every time I'm there. And I can absolutely, without reservation or hesitation, and I ask some good, you know, questions, I think that, well, they're important to me. And Roxanne, bam, right off the top, just straight up, right to the core, man. Right to the bloody core, absolutely. And you know, I would encourage everybody, if you haven't already, make every effort to go and take the tour, to embrace phase one. That's what it is. There is a procedure to this effort, that this is not some hodgepodge idea of things that are, it's not from the ground or the top down. It's a whole bunch of established procedures that have been accomplished and that are in effect right now being undertaken. Phase two being a major motion picture. This experimental cities, everything is emergent. And so what can you, what would you suggest to people, you know, about taking the tour?
Well, I mean, the tour is really, like you said, I mean, there's absolutely no difference with the tour as far as how it was before and how it is now. We've only missed one tour, so basically that was right the first weekend after Jacques died. And then after that, the weekend, you know, the weekend after Roxanne and Joel and myself, we're already doing the tours just like we've always done. One of the things that is special about the tour is that it's, you know, it's something that's real.
Yes.
I mean, you know, you come here and you can see it, you can touch it, you know, to a good degree. You get a pretty good layout of at least a small part of, you know, what it would be like. And then of course all the experiences that you get from here and other people that are here, all that stuff, you know, is something that is definitely motivational.
Yes.
For you to try and do more in this direction. At least that's, you know, how it always was for me.
Yeah.
And still is that way, you know, especially with all the people that come for the tour and you know, afterwards we make an effort to always go out and have dinner, you know, if there's people there so that we can talk afterwards too. And you know, without exception so far as I've seen, you know, there people are always so, you know, happy that they came and they,
yes,
you know, leave with a lot of impressions. So so yeah, that's, you know, that's really, there's really no less of a reason to come over now that Jacques's not here. And then additionally, like, you know, like Roxanne already mentioned too in her, you know, in her announcement and whatnot, the tours themselves haven't really changed a lot for the last couple of years. It was, you know, it was already her that she did most of the tours. You know, Jacques would only do the part of the tour where he would sit down and talk to everybody, and you know, and with everything, you know, being as it was with Parkinson's and whatnot,
right,
Roxanne would do, you know, mostly everything, and she easily can do everything anyway.
Totally.
So there's no unknowns now. It's, you know, it's all the same. So there's definitely, I would definitely invite everybody to come over. I'm not here permanently, so I can't, you know, I can't make a promise that I'll take you out to dinner. But if we're here, we usually make an effort to go out. So there's a lot of socializing.
It was totally far out. I met so many wonderful people that even today we have wonderful friendships. And it's something for those activists that you take back with you, that you take this experience because it's real to you. You've developed a personal relationship with Roxanne and the research center, and you're able to use this in your activism. You're able to describe all of the experiences that you had and what you learned. So it's an essential tool. It also is the fundamental of phase one, and helps for people to understand phase two and the other processes that are needed and are instrumental in attaining a resource-based economy. So I appreciate your insight on that, and I would go every time that I could. And I always learn. I learned so many far out new things. And the one thing I thought was really cool is that it seemed like to me that there was more interaction, that she was asking people and people would chime in. There was more interaction with those in regards to the models, to the city, to the cybernated systems. It was so far out. People became involved with that, that we understand that it's up to human beings. It's up to us in the forefront of this direction to become knowledgeable and to that we're all participants in this, that we're all united in a common theme that unites us all. And the research center is a wonderful, wonderful example of that. It's real, and we encourage everybody to try to make every effort that they can. I want to bring up, you know, everything is based on, in today, on a monetary system, but no one would ever be denied because they don't have enough money. That anyone who made every effort and could try what they could in their monetary possession, and no one has ever, ever been turned away because they didn't have a whole bunch of money, and that everyone is invited. And in addition, that's exemplified through all of the hundreds and hundreds of hours that are available, given unto everyone to learn more from Jacques and Roxanne and other activists and their efforts to help each other and to spread this knowledge. So a very important tool that's available to everyone.
Yeah, there's a lot of, I mean, most of the work that gets done is basically, you know, is freely available. So the things that are sold at the moment basically are just sold so that we can support the center here. That's really Jacques and Roxanne, you know, printed their own books all these years, you know, nobody. Yeah. And we'll continue to do, you know, to do so. So, there's a lot of things, going on. Like I said, there's a lot of things in the background that are not, not very sexy and fashionable and whatnot, but there's still a lot of work that gets done in the background. We are going to have some updates that are going to be coming out now, mainly the stuff with the Get Involved and the education that we were already talking about. We're going to have also quite a few new languages into which the Best That Money Can't Buy book is going to be translated. So I think by the end of the year, we're going to have a total of 13 ebooks. Ebooks in 13 different languages, and Slovenian and Serbian language books are also going to be printed if we can pull that off. That's the plan. And then a new edition of the English book is also going to be printed, meaning that the 8th edition is going to come out. And so all that, of course, takes some collaborating. And the book as it is going to be formatted kind of for all the languages the same from now on.
Wow.
So it's going to be the same format, and it's going to be, you know, it's going to be kind of a template format for all the books. And there's been some updates in the book, not big ones, but just some of the grammatical and stylist and stuff like that.
Out of sight.
So so all that is getting wrapped up. Now it's for me personally been one of the longest running projects that I've been involved with. So I will not lie, and I'll tell you that I will be very happy that when it's over and the book is printed and it's out for me. So all those things. Another thing that's of course going on that Roxanne also mentioned already is the resource-based economy nonprofit organization.
Yes.
It's been announced a while back. There's still some things that need to be done, need to get done for it to be completely ready. So there's no specific time on that, but that's definitely the next step.
Yeah, tremendously exciting developments and a tremendous amount of work that people are just not aware of. And it's just so empowering to know that. And making great, accelerated efforts. And it's just wonderful. Sure appreciate it. If you had some parting words to talk to activists that are right now, you know, this evening or this afternoon out in the streets trying to help people know, what would be some of the suggestions that you could offer from your experiences? What would you say to those that are out there in the field right now?
Well, yeah, I don't think there's any universal paragraph that I could say right now that is gonna you know, make a difference. I mean, I hope that from all that you've heard, I guess, last week from Sue and from me and all the people that are gonna be coming after, you know, I hope that some of the things that we're talking about are going to make sense to you and you know, motivate you maybe to do the next to make the next step. Really the struggle is from, you know, going from the general support of the project and doing the next step to actually getting involved. That's, you know, that's the hardest step. And if you know, if there's any way that you can do that step, that's gonna be, you know, that's gonna be something that will, that might change things in the future. And the more people that do that, the more chance we're gonna have of getting things done. You know, like I think it's been said over and over by Jacques before, and we're gonna continue to say the same thing, you know, just Roxanne or Roxanne and Joel and me and, you know, the couple of people, it's not going to happen with a few people. You know, we need a lot more people, and that those people are out there, and they don't necessarily have to be, you know, any kind of brilliant scientist or whatnot. It can be just, you know, just about anybody. As long as you put in the time and you're interested and you want to learn and you want to do things, yeah.
And tons of tools available for them to help them along the way.
Yeah, once you're far enough to make that next step, you know, just don't give up. If we, you know, if somebody doesn't answer right away or if you don't get through to the team or the person that you want right away, just don't stop. We're gonna be here, and you know, and we need people to get involved. So,
they're not alone. You're not alone in this.
No.
You just may not see a lot of it in your town yet. That's why you're there. That we are not alone, and that millions of people all over this world, every single person in this world wants a better world. They want to live as long as they can, to have the time to spend with those they love and care about. They want a world where people can get along, and those of us that have taken it upon ourselves to take our place, stand up and help others to learn this direction, to make it real and to make it happen, to enact a resource-based economy, you're not alone. And all of those at the Research Center organization are behind you and appreciate what you're doing. And we just so applaud each and every one of you that are out there doing all that you can with the limited amount of either resources or knowledge that you have, a willingness and want to see this happen. And we support you in that, and we'll do everything that we can to help empower and give you those tools to help you do just that. So, you know, Sasha, I sure appreciate you, brother. And I know everyone does. Sometimes, we in our backgrounds haven't been taught to say thank you. And sometimes it's just a given that, you know, and some people don't do it for the thanks. Some people find it difficult to have others acknowledge them. And I want to take the opportunity just to thank you, your wonderful wife, which we're going to have an interview. I want to bring that up. We're going to have an interview with her sometime in the future, hopefully next week. She is the social media coordinator and does a tremendous amount of work all over the place. Wherever she is, she's doing it. And so I just acknowledge you both and thank you and encourage everyone to try to make sure that they can friend you and that when it comes to any of these training opportunities, that with the POC that they can contact you if they'd like to begin, that they can contact Sue, and we have a nice list that we have available. And there's a new website that I developed for Activism Insights. We have tools for you there, and we're going to have the POC list available, and they can contact you if they're interested in beginning it or learning more about it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, we should. I mean, we try to make ourselves available to the best of our abilities.
Yeah.
The last month or so has been pretty hectic with everything. I've gotten so many messages, which, you know, just thank you everybody. I've talked to Roxanne on a daily basis here, and she's getting swamped with all the emails too, and she's very thankful that for all the support and everything. But ultimately it's up to what we do. You know, it's great to like I said, to acknowledge everything that's been in the past, but it's what we do from now on. I don't know, maybe the last thing before you go, before you said parting words, I would say to those that do get interested and to those that do get excited about these things, keep in mind that this is a marathon, that this is not a sprint. It's not going to be a sprint. It's going to be a marathon. So we got a lot of work ahead of ourselves. So pace yourself, and not everybody's going to go along with it. Expect that. Don't expect everybody to immediately agree with you. They won't. I guarantee it. Keep that in mind and try to improve your tools and try to, you know, get to know more and more and get better at explaining these things. And
yes.
And that's really not something that can be explained in a 30-minute
interview,
but it's something that you just have to do and hopefully get some help now that it's available. So contact us. We'll do our best.
Got a site. Well, sure. Thank you. And with that, we're going to come to a close. Be sure to check out. We'll have links. We'll have Sasha's page up there. And any other information he feels relevant, we'll make sure that there's links for you all. And appreciate everybody for coming out. Thanks a lot, Sasha. I can't thank you enough for taking the time out, brother.
Oh, pleasure.
All right. So, well, goodbye, everybody. Be sure to look for the next one. We're going to try to do this each week. And we'll see you next time.
Take care.
Bye, everybody.